heights of a triangle are concurrent. All right, so now with the help of the dot product, we'll do another problem that, yes, we've done before. I'm hoping you don't remember the geometric proof of it. And that is the fact that the heights of a triangle, in this case, we'll consider an acute triangle, but this method works for any triangle, intersect at a single point. In other words, they're concurrent. The heights of a triangle are concurrent. That's what we're going to prove. Okay? And you will find, once again, that this approach will be completely straightforward and not require any ingenuity. And I keep saying it like it's a good thing, and it is a good thing. It's a tribute to our framework. So here's my overall strategy. I will locate this point vector algebraically, and then I will prove that this line, I will draw it later, from the origin, I'll choose this to be my origin, to this, is orthogonal to the opposite side. So strap yourselves in. Once again, I practiced doing this, and things were labor-intensive algebraically, but labor-intensive doesn't mean not straightforward. So let's see where we get. So the way we'll vectorize this problem, in other words, impose vector structure onto a pure geometric problem, is in our usual way, we'll call this the vector A. We'll call this the vector B. Okay, let's see now. We now need this vector right here, right? The height represented by this vector, so that we can take, again, we'll start alphabetically. So we need this one first, right? So we can say that the phi portion of it lands right at this point. So that will be our one path to this point. And our other path to this point will be going to the tip of B and then expressing this height as a vector and going the amount psi from B and arriving at the same point. Okay, but now you can see that we need the dot product. This is very different from the several problems we did until now, because there is no way to translate a right angle into vector algebra without using the dot product. So this problem is not affine. This problem is Euclidean. You need lengths and angles, and you need, therefore, the dot product. We will start with A first, right? And so what we have here is projection. If I pointed it this way, consistently with what I just did a moment ago, this is the projection of A away from B. Let me just help you see it. This vector right here would be the projection of A onto B, right? And so this vector right here is the projection of A away from B. Okay, so let's call it, I used Q before, so I'm gonna call it Q1. So this vector is Q1. Okay? I'll write here what Q1 equals. This is nice. Things are already not the shortest or the simplest, but they're completely straightforward. We need to know what this vector is, so we just did. We just expressed it. Okay, and now I can express this point, which will be A, and then minus the proportion phi of this vector. Minus because we're going in the opposite direction. So let's write that down. And maybe in a moment, I'll introduce some shortcuts. I'm very tempted to write this as undecorated B squared, because it is the length of B squared. So there is a lot to write here, so maybe I'll start thinking of shortcuts. B. And so do you guys see how we've already basically solved the problem, right? Because we, at this point, we can see that the strategy will work out. I will now do the same thing, but via B, and I will end up with one two-dimensional vector equation and two unknowns. So I'll be able to solve for phi and psi. Therefore, I'll be able to express the vector from here to here, and I will only need to dot it with a minus b, which represents this side, and make sure that it equals zero to prove that the line that passes through this point is orthogonal to the opposite base. Now we'll arrive at this point the opposite way, and I can just sort of do it by analogy. It's the same as going to b and then going the portion psi, the fraction psi, in the direction of projection of b away from a. Now I will again collect like terms, equate the coefficients of a linear combination of linearly independent vectors to zero, and then solve for phi and psi. That's a little bit of work, but it's good work. It's very structured work. Okay, so let's collect like terms. A So what we're about to do is to say this is a linear combination of two linearly independent vectors, and since this equals zero, each coefficient must equal zero. And you can look at this and say one of two opposite things. You can look at this and say, my goodness, this is so complicated, and the expression is so big and scary. Or you could look at it and say, this is so simple. This is just a linear system with two equations and two unknowns, because the quantities that you're looking for that are unknown, phi and psi, are participating in this expression linearly. So this is just a linear system with two equations and two unknowns, and each one of us has solved hundreds of those. So let's just write it in the matrix form. That's our system of equations. And now let's invert it. Should I remind you of the formula? Why don't I remind you of the formula for the inverse? Now I will take a notational shortcut, because let's think about this. The determinant, let's talk about the determinant. Okay. So this actually has a direct geometric interpretation. Because if you think about it, this is the length of A times the length of B times the cosine of the angle between them. So, and because it's squared, it's the length of A squared times the length of B squared times the cosine of gamma squared. Yeah, that's where it's going. And this is the length of a squared, and this is the length of b squared, canceling everything except the square of the cosine of gamma, right? Let's put gamma, right? So we have 1 minus cosine squared of gamma, so it becomes sine squared of gamma. So this, on the one hand, breaks our trying to express everything in terms of the dot products, but I'll just leave this on as a reminder that the sine squared of gamma is directly expressed in terms of the dot products exclusively and elementary arithmetic operations. So, equals 1 over the determinant. Okay, and just as before, we only need to get to this point, we only need either phi or psi, so we'll go for phi, right? And then evaluate this expression. From here, phi is in the first row. Okay, so now that I have phi, I can actually express, yeah, let's use some color, what this vector p is, because it's right here. It's a minus phi times this. Okay, so our vector p equals. Let's write it as a linear combination of a and b. Let's see what we get. Okay, equals. And now I will simplify it in place. Here's what will happen. When I combine these two fractions, I will get sine squared of gamma minus 1, which is cosine squared of gamma, right? So that's nice that it's not getting much more complicated than that. Cosine squared of gamma, and then this becomes plus. So let me just change it in place. This is just shorthand expressions for dot products. Okay, plus b. Now let's get all the signs right. So when we're multiplying this by this, this gets a minus sign, this gets a positive sign, and then this minus flips all of them. So I believe it's this. Did I get the signs right? I think we're good. And this is once again cosine squared gamma. Am I right? That's nice. So there is perfect symmetry between the coefficient of A and the coefficient of B. Yeah, so that's very nice. It's much simpler almost than I could have expected because I'm replacing this familiar combination with cosine squared gamma. And that's this vector P right here. The only part that remains is to prove that P dotted with A minus B. So once again, we have to prove orthogonality. And the only way to do it is through the dot product. Equals zero. We need to show that this equals zero. Well, let's figure out what it is. P equals this. Am I going to copy it? Here's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to dot A minus B. I'm going to dot it with P, which means, right, I need to dot this with B minus A. Okay, great. So we just need to multiply this out, and let's collect all the terms that will happen. Because we're going, our goal is to show that this dot product equals zero, you guys will agree with me that we can just ignore this denominator, because it scales the whole thing, right? So if ignoring sine squared of gamma would get zero, then with it we would get zero as well. Okay, here are the four terms. When A meets A dotted with A, it's just this expression right here. And because A gets dotted with A, I just have to multiply this by A dotted with A. So we have A dotted with B minus cosine squared gamma of A dotted with A. Do you guys see that? Do you see where this came from? Because we have A times this coefficient dotted with A. Because it's A dotted with A, that's just the number, A dotted with A. So that number multiplies this one right here, cancels this, and remains here. So it's A dot B minus cosine squared gamma, A dotted with A. Okay, great. Now when A meets B, we're picking up a minus sign and then a factor of A dotted with B. So it's minus. Okay, next. It is what it is. So let's see what we have. We have A dotted with B canceling A dotted with B. If I made a mistake, I made a mistake. See, there are a few things that are not canceling, which is good. Cosine squared A dotted with B. Cosine squared A dotted with B. Okay, that's good. Let's pair up this one with this one. Okay, and factor out B dotted with B. When we do that and factor out B dotted with B, right? And that's zero, because this is minus cosine squared gamma, and this is plus cosine squared gamma. So I will use like-colored markers to cross them out, because they're this actually cancels this. And green cancellation, similarly, this cancels this. And we're left with one big fat zero. Thus, the vector P, which is right here, that's a straight line that would pass us through this point where the first two heights intersect, is orthogonal to B minus A, QED. So, revel in the straightforwardness of this all and accept the algebraic challenge of it, which I see as completely straightforward, even if the expressions get a little large.